So, Siobhan, of course, like mentioned, at a high level of certain use cases where we are using WSUDO's things within our internal IT. And I'm going to talk about something very specific. I'm going to take a particular product and explain how we are using this particular product internally to solve a very specific problem that we are having, probably also having. So let me begin by asking a question. Okay? How many internal applications you guys are using? I see any internal applications that you guys are using, and how many of them are? Hundred plus. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. So I actually read somewhere. Within IBM, they have close to 50,000 internal applications developed for different purposes. Right? Now, WSUDO is not there. We are just having somewhere close to 50 plus applications. Right? Now, in this case, to explain the situation and the scenario a little bit better, I'm going to do a little bit of a role playing. Right? And I'm going to take the role of Siri. Right? Siri is somebody from WSUDO's sales team. Right? And me, Siri, I'm going to talk to a customer, and I want to find what are the patches this particular customer is having in their runtime, WSUDO patches. Right? Now, for this, we have a separate application that allows me to go in and check the number of patches a particular customer is having. Now, this particular statement, I'm Siri from WSUDO, has certain things that are common. Right? One is Siri, the name, the username, the name that I have, the identity I have within the enterprise. Then WSUDO, the organization, can be anything. Right? And sales team, a role, a permission. Right? With that, I log into this particular URL, apps.wsudo.com. This is actually a public URL, but hopefully you won't be able to go any further beyond that unless you have a valid WSUDO set of credentials. Now, this is our App Store. Now, this is done using the product called WSUDO App Manager. So when I, Siri, log into this particular page, right, this is the login page that I'm seeing. I go in here, and I enter my WSO2 credentials. Yes, okay, in the login screen. Right? So I get redirected into the IDP, central IDP, because we maintain all our users in a single user repository. If you have been to Dimuthu's presentation yesterday about how we manage single sign-on between our applications, she had the complete thing. So I'm being redirected to idp.wsudo.com, where I enter my credentials. I get validated centrally, and I get redirected into the original URL that I have requested, apps.wsudo.com. Now, this is our App Store, which lists out all the applications that we have internally. And I see only the applications that I'm supposed to see and that are being recommended by others to me. That's a feature we don't have right now, but it's coming up. And then, out of these applications, there are certain set of applications, we call it subscriptions, that I have selected, telling, OK, I'm using these applications on a day-to-day basis. So actually, when I log in, I'm being taken to this particular page, because these are my frequently used applications. Now, from here, I can access those applications, but I can also find different applications based on different categories. Say, for example, if somebody new joins in, if a friend comes to WSUDO and I want to share an internet connectivity with that particular person, there's an application categorized under infra, which allows me to create a temporary password. So I log into here, and then I access the particular application that I want to access, which is, in this case, it's called the patch management application. I'm sorry, the screens look better here, but it looks a bit blurred here. Now, this is the application. So when I want to click, you access this application, I go in and click on this icon, and I'm being taken into the IDP. I logged in once, but this is just a verification check. And then I get landed on the real application that I want to access. Right? So this actually has certain values which I've like blurred out because they are sensitive. Right? But the trick here is, or the beauty here is, I didn't have to, this is a separate application, a completely different application, but I didn't have to log into this application. I got automatically logged in because I logged in, I got myself logged into the central IDP, and the system is aware of that. Then, I'm a bit of a, like, even though I'm from sales, I'm a bit of a technical guy. So I see that there's a SAML response that comes in from the comes into my browser, which has certain details about me, telling, okay, I'm Siri, and I have these roles, so some details. So what just happened behind the scenes? First is, I accessed the Enterprise App Store, and I saw all the applications that I'm allowed to see. Sorry, before that I got logged into the central IDP. And I got single signed on into all the enterprise applications that I'm allowed to access. Okay. I'm happy because of several things. I see all the applications that I'm supposed to see in a single place. Just imagine this particular person, Siri, being a new user. Rather than like having to go and talk to 10 different people to figure out what are the applications he or she has to do, has to access, everything is listed in a single place where like you access a single URL and get all the applications. And at the same time, you can also get recommendations, or you can even like recommend certain applications for your team. And then I use a single set of credentials to access all these applications. Some of these applications are not developed within WSO2. So for example, we have something called People HR, where we are dealing with the human resource management issues. And that's a separate application. We have our own expense management system, which is a separate application. But all these applications are available for any user, and Siri in this case, under a single set of credentials. And I also see, like if I'm new, I also see user guides, documentations, examples on how to use a particular application under the same App Store. You click on that, and there's a separate documentation page. And I can also like request for certain features by the application developer. So there's a direct communication from me as an end user to the application developer, the person who has developed the application, or who's responsible for managing all the CRs, change request. And this is pretty much common in many enterprises, many large enterprises, maybe not in small ones. But and in fact, the requirement for this particular product came in from a client, a real client. But we ended up using it ourselves. And this particular pattern, an end user discovering an application, is not an uncommon thing. It's actually like can be summarized into something like this. So you go in and discover applications through App Store. That is where the place you go in and discover app stores, apps. And then you might want to tell, OK, I'm going to use this application. So there are different ways of doing that. One thing is subscription. You go in and click. Okay, I'm going to subscribe to this application so that I can keep on using it. And in some systems, that subscription may require to pay something. Okay? Or else, if the applications are free, the concept of favorites. I favorite this application, or I share this application to another set of recommend users. Then I keep on, if the application is new to me, I might want to read the documents, or else I keep on accessing the application, and I might even submit issues or feature requests. So this is a common pattern, application discovery for an end user. Then I'm switching roles from Siri. Siri was just an ordinary user, to the role of Nayana, who's part of WSO2 CIO team. which Shivan talked little bit about. Now, in Nayana's case, he develops applications for internal use, or he's at least responsible for making sure that there's an application for a given purpose, given requirement. Okay? And he wants to have an effective way of distributing these applications, rather than going and telling all the 500 employees, okay, we have this particular application, a place where he can publish applications and everybody else sees, or get notified. Okay? And then I don't want to like write an application and do the repetitive process of authentication and authorization in each and every application. I want that to be offloaded into somewhere else, so that I only focus on the logic, and my application gets a verifier telling, okay, the particular user who's trying to access your application is authenticated and is having these privileges. So I trust that, which is the IDP. I trust what is coming from the IDP and write my application. And I also want to make use of the centrally defined user attributes. So for example, like if you are having one database for a set of users and another database for another set of users, same set of users for two different applications, your model won't scale. Rather, this particular product allows you to have all the users in one user repository and fronted by your IDP, which isolates the problem of user management, identity management, and profile management. And me as a developer, application developer, I might also want to see some statistics about how people are using my applications, etc. So that is my expectation as an application developer. So in Nayana's case, he uses a component called App Publisher, that is in the App Manager, to create these applications so that end users will get to know about these. So these are some of the capabilities that are available within the publisher. Right? So there's a particular UI which allows you to enter certain details about the application. Right? Now here, we are primarily focusing on web applications. So what we do is, there's a real web application, and within the app publisher, we create a proxy web application through which requests flow through, and it reaches the final application. But since we have a proxy application, we can do certain things in between the end user and the real application. So this is the place where me as Nayana, the app publisher, creates that proxy web application. And it also allows, since the proxy web application acts as an interceptor, it also allows me to specify certain criteria for certain access patterns. So, like different resource paths, different, like it can be based on HTTP verbs, or it can be based on different URL patterns, or it can be based on different query parameters. So I specify different resource-based access or throttling policies. Now these policies can be globally defined, so that a given enterprise have a defined set of policies, and you can reuse them across different applications. And they also can be grouped, so that it makes management of the infra very easy. So you have a group which tells, okay, these are the policies that should be applied for developers or for finance guys. Okay. And you can also customize the patterns. Okay. And then, me as a publisher, this is the detail page that I get to see about a particular application that I am managing or that I have published. So this central place allows me to access all the details about the application, starting from the documentation, how the SSO is configured, or if OAuth is supported, how OAuth keys are defined, all that. And it also allows me to create versions, a new version of the application, so that I can keep on evolving what I have published, what I have delivered. And documentation. So three types of documentation support. Either you can provide the documentation inline, for application that I want to publish. There's a separate editor, and it creates an inline documentation which will be available in the App Store. Or else I can submit URLs, or else I can upload documents, PDFs that I've created offline. And me as a publisher, I also get to perform certain things. So what you don't see here, but what is mentioned here is submit to review. So I create this proxy application, which I want to publish into the App Store. But based on my privileges, I'm not allowed to publish. It has to go through a separate process, another person, for reviewal. Right? So different actions that I can do as a publisher based on the privileges that I'm having. So it's a life cycle based situation. And I also get a central view of all the applications that I've published or about to be published. And I can also publish mobile applications. All this time I have been focusing on the web applications, but we also support acting as a mobile app store. Similar to the case of Siri, the end user, Niner's case is also very common. There are many people, many engineers, who are developing applications for internal usage. Right? And those people need a way, a channel, to tell rest of the world, rest of the organization about the applications that they developed. And they also have a requirement to upgrade. Right? So this also can be put into a common pattern like this. There are many other cases, but many other nodes, but I have just tried to generalize it. So first of all, like I write an application, it goes through a review process, which can either get rejected, or if it is approved, I can either publish it, or else, if it is a published application, I can unpublish it. And in order to manage the lifecycle of the application, I might even decide, okay, we are going to deprecate this application and finally retire after a certain amount of period. So this is the typical lifecycle of application publishing. And of course, for applications to be published, somebody needs to develop it. So I won't be talking about application development lifecycle because everyone of us are familiar with that. But this is something that happens after that. There's an application that is fully functional. So once I publish applications, I want to review statistics about these applications. How these applications are being used, what are the popular applications, what are the features that a particular user is asking. So App Manager also supports some metadata level analytics at out-of-box level. So what I meant by metadata level is, now there are very specific things that are very specific about the application, which we are not capable of capturing. So because of that, we do certain metadata level analytics, which you're going to see in a while. And we also have an extensible way of defining your own analytics. Say, for example, you might want to have a report where, like, if somebody is violating a certain validation criteria on a particular page, that is very specific to that application. Now, we are not capable of doing that, but it can be extended so that you, as an application developer, can do that. Now, these are some of the metadata level statistics that are available. So for example, now this guy is showing usage by resource page. For a given application, there could be 10 URLs, and you might want to check what is the most popular page of my application. Or else, you might, like, this provides a multi-dimensional view of the particular application on x-axis, and the number of subscriptions. How many people are using this application, and the popularity. So this bubble increases based on the popularity. And this guy is showing the response time of a given application deployment. Say you might be having 50 applications deployed, and you might want to find which application is the slowest, because there could be certain users who are using that application, and that is creating problems. And a subscription overview, based on the application version. And like per user subscription statistics, and a breakdown of performance by the backend endpoint. So all in all, both of these user categories, Siri, which is the end user, and Niner, which is the application publisher, are happy because Niner has a way of distributing his applications effectively and getting rid of certain boilerplate code, authentication authorization, and providing single sign-on capabilities for his applications. And at the same time, Siri is happy because there's a central place through which the applications can be accessed using single set of credentials. Now, this a functional overview of how we achieve those capabilities. So basically, we have broken the particular product, App Manager, into three main components. The application publisher, through which the applications get published, the application store, where end users will see the applications, and an application gateway, actually this is a web application gateway, through which all the calls will get routed, so that we can apply certain things. And then comes the backend application, the real application. And of course, to facilitate this particular process, we use the IDP, which is the WSO2 identity server. And there are certain concepts behind this particular whole process. One is, I have only spoken about the web applications in detail, but we also support mobile applications. And we are in the process of supporting command line applications. Now what this means is, like, when you say apt-get install on a Linux shell, it goes into the Ubuntu repository. Right? But what if you can have an intermediate repository that actually you control to figure out whether this particular user, enterprise user, can install this application? That is the direction of the command line applications. Another concept behind this particular process is something called JWT, or a SAML token. Now, the backend application, I said the backend application developer trusts that the request that he is getting is already authenticated and authorized. Now, how that authentication and authorization is passed on the backend application is via either a signed JSON web token, so it's signed and encrypted, could even be encrypted, or a SAML token. So based on any of these things, I assume, OK, I don't have to worry about this particular user. It's already been taken care of by the IDP. And there's a defined set of defined signature for both of these, so that I can read, OK, what are the roles this particular user is having? OK, or else, are there any special policies that are defined against this particular user? So that I can make use of those in my application to populate menus or give out certain functions, etc. And okay, this is the content of the JSON web token. Say, for example, here I happen to have the roles that the user is having, the username, the time the JSON web token is valid, okay, and the claim values. Say, for example, email address, telephone number, which I can use within my application. And the SAML token is also having something similar, which is pretty much the standard. And we also support publishing statistics into Google, so that you can see your application access statistics, but which is not a very common case in a case of an enterprise app store, because that is very constrained into your enterprise environment. Okay. But even though I didn't mention, like, we support publishing statistics into the WSO2 DAS, so that you can see the access statistics through that. And I happen to mention this, the application publishing workflow can be, it can be workflow control, so that anybody cannot publish an application. Similarly, how an application is being accessed is, can also be controlled by the by the infra, telling, okay, only, like, if somebody can send in a request to access an application, but that doesn't mean it's granted. It may go through a workflow process where certain verifications are done and allowed. So I'm coming to the end of this slide, this particular session. And I just want to mention some of the future work that we are doing. Okay? One is we're actually rewriting the application gateway on top of the new gateway that we have developed. So it is supposed to be pretty fast. And we are going to, like, redo the throttling on top of the complex event processor capabilities, so that it's more extensible, and also, like, it's far more performant. And subscription, right now, the concept of subscription is pretty much tied into the product. If you want to use an application, you need to go in and tell, I want to subscribe, which may not be the case for like some users. So we are going to like have a flexible subscription model. And having something called mobile catalog. Say, for example, if you guys are having an Android or an iOS, what you see on your device is called a mobile catalog. That is not the App Store, original App Store that they are having, but it's called a catalog. So we are going to support the same concept and make this work as a IoT application firmware delivery platform. So that for devices, you can send, you can use this to send firmware updates or applications. Publisher subscriber based application distribution model so that you get notified and you can also subscribe to certain type of applications, etc. Okay.